Oakland, California, October 17th, 1967.
Two columns of Oakland policemen, wearing helmets and carrying clubs, filed out of the garage and lined up in a wedge formation across Clay Street. A large number of California State Highway patrolmen lined up 20 abreast in a military formation that stretched for more than half a block behind the wedge of policemen. At 7 o'clock, the police were ordered by loudspeaker to move forward at a half step, and those demonstrators who did not move out of the way fast enough were shoved and beaten by the first ranks of police using nightsticks.
They come. The policemen are moving straight forward at a walking pace, moving the crowd back. The policemen are clubbing the people very badly, mostly reporters. People have fallen into the street, shoving CBS News cameramen, pushing them to the ground, smashing their equipment. Cops are yelling. They are attempting to split off. There's going to be nothing left of any of the cars parked in the lots. They're completely crumpled. Policemen are still moving down the main street. Balance, maybe.
Okay.
Hell no! 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 Hell no!
Policemen are beating the people very badly, beating and beating them continually, smashing the people in their heads again and again and again.
Shortly after 9 o'clock, several busloads of inductees drove between the lines of policemen to the front of the induction center, and shortly thereafter, the monitors of the demonstration, using walkie-talkies to coordinate their activities, directed the demonstrators to gather in a nearby park. Many of them were also present later at a noon rally held on the Berkeley campus of the University of California. This is Don Porche reporting for Pacifica News.
Thank you.
Pacifica Radio presents Vietnam, the Opposition.
This was the week that Senator Eugene McCarthy declared his candidacy for the Democratic presidential nomination. Assistant Secretary of State Charles Frankel resigned, reportedly in opposition to the Vietnam policies of the Johnson administration. Robert McNamara's move to the World Bank was made public, and the most brutal battles of the war in Vietnam were fought. As the war in Vietnam continues to escalate, its repercussions at home escalate also. The more militant wing of the anti-war movement moved from protest to resistance on October 21st at the Pentagon, and there has also been an escalation of protest activities that do not involve physical confrontation. Our summing up of recent anti-war actions begins with a discussion of one of the non-marching protests. On November 8th, 50,000 anti-war declarations were delivered to the United Nations by Mr. and Mrs. Herbert Magidson, a California couple who have founded a group known as Individuals Against the Crime of Silence. They discuss the declaration.
Ours is not just another petition in that sense. It's an individually signed declaration. It's witnessed by the United Nations. It's a very strong declaration. There is no political program involved with it in any way. We're not a political organization or a participating organization. The statement is very clear and speaks out strongly against the war and says that each person who signs it will oppose it and will not obey the government when it demands heinous crimes along the lines of what was worked out at Nuremberg. In other words, it leaves it up to individual responsibility. In addition to that, what we've done is, I think we have a rather good follow-up program. For example, everyone who signs this declaration receives four letters from us, actually five. There's a cover letter bringing them up to date about our program. But these four letters that we send back to them are addressed to the President, their U.S. Senators, and their U.S. Congressmen. And it has a space for them to sign their name and also write their own comments. And they follow up by sending these letters into their representatives saying, and putting these representatives on notice that they've signed their name to this declaration, and it lists the declaration, and literally they tell them that they're on record with the United Nations opposing the war. So about 1,800 to 2,000 of these each week arrive to the office of the President and proportionally to the senators and congressmen, and we feel that this has some value. And then, of course, the Office of the Individuals Against the Crime of Silence regularly notifies all of the representatives, how many people have signed, and we try to do this in as much of the news media as we can also, because we feel they too will witness the fact that we have this program opposing the war.
I was going to say that we also receive many signed declarations from people in the armed forces, some on their way to Vietnam who sign before they go. And this has been very touching. Some letters that we turn over to the ACLU, because the people ask for help and what they should do, and we don't give any advice at all, but just turn them over to the ACLU.
But you view this, then, as only one part, though, of a total protest against
the war. Oh, yes, yes. We're just one part of a total protest. We think we have some value. The extent of it is not easy to measure. But I think if we can get to people to not remain silent and to possibly hear what we're doing in Vietnam and see what we're doing in Vietnam and not just repress it and then speak out about it and hopefully from there to take action on an individual basis of their own in any way they see fit to do it as an individual, then maybe we are accomplishing something. But we have no really positive way of knowing just what we're accomplishing. It's very difficult.
I just wanted to say that I don't only feel bad about what we're doing in Vietnam, but I feel especially bad about what we're doing in our own country by mixing up our priorities when we have so many problems with the civil rights and with the lack of money for education and lack of money for transportation and water pollution and air pollution and population explosion problems, that we should switch our priorities around like this seems a shame.
Another of the quiet protests is the effort of a group of artists and writers who will refuse to pay a part of their income tax. New York Times staffer Kurt Sale and noted critic Dwight McDonald discussed the tax withholding action with WBAI's Larry Josephson. We first hear Mr. Sale.
The goals are simple. First, a pledge not to pay the 10% or any other war-directed surcharge, if it gets passed. And secondly, that many of us will not pay the 23% that we estimate is used of our taxes to support the Vietnam War right now. And it's as simple as that. The goals ultimately are complex. You can't tell what's going to happen, what effect might be. The idea is to get as many concerned people to take an appropriate action against the war as you can get. And we'd be happy if all the millions of people who are against the war also refuse their taxes.
That would put quite a crimp in the...
Well, yes and no.
It
put a big crimp in the IRS, but I'm not sure how much of a crimp it would put in the war machine. The IRS is empowered to come and collect the taxes that you withhold. And they go to your bank account and take the money, and they take another 6% interest from you as well. So that ultimately the government can, if it chooses, go in and get the money. It's not a question so much of refusing them the money as of the civil disobedience of refusing to go along with their game.
Yeah, I think that's the... It's a symbolic thing more than anything else, really.
Yeah.
But I might say that just from a practical point of view, one of the things that attracts me about the... especially the 10% refusal, is that it's apparently would cost the government almost more, really, to collect it.
Yes.
Than they would get. So it has a certain nuisance value that way.
We figure that if you get the IRS agents running all over the country, going into bank accounts and hunting down the money of all the people we've got, that that'll give them a big problem.
You have...
And also, there's a point that... There are on this list some fairly distinguished people who have incomes of quite a bit and who might temporarily put a small crimp in the amount of money the government has to work with. I mean, I don't know how much Dr. Benjamin Spock really makes, what 10% of his income would be, or 23%, but...
10% of his tax.
Of his tax, yeah. But he's a pretty good-selling author, and it's of some merit that he is on the list as well.
And there has been an escalation of communication between Americans opposed to the war and representatives of the North Vietnamese and the National Liberation Front. The interviewer you will hear next was required to submit written questions in advance. Following the interview, remarks by Tom Hayden, who returned from Hanoi to the glare of the camera lights.
This is Carol McEldowney. The following interview with Mrs. Tu Hung is being taped on October 16, 1967, in Hanoi, Democratic Republic of Vietnam. Mrs. Hung is an English language announcer for the Voice of Vietnam. She has a daily broadcast to American GIs in South Vietnam who know her as Hanoi Hannah. Mrs. Hung, could you please tell us a little bit about yourself, about your family, about when you first became involved in the resistance movement?
I was born in and grew up in Hanoi. Our people have suffered much under foreign domination. I love my country and my people. I could not bear the presence of foreign troops occupying my country. I am married. We have two children, a boy and a girl. Since U.S. aircraft began to bomb and strafe North Vietnam, our children had to be evacuated far from Hanoi to continue their studies. You know, for a mother, this is a sacrifice to be separated from her children. But we are ready to accept this sacrifice because it is necessary in our present fight to preserve our independence and freedom.
I want to announce that Sergeants Johnson, Jackson, and Pitzer are here. They arrived with me on the Pan Am flight, and my understanding is that Jackson and Pitzer are now on their way to Fort Bragg, North Carolina, and that Sergeant Johnson is on his way to Walter Reed Hospital in Washington. Now, needless to say, I am incredibly happy that they have returned to the United States. And I hope that they will be returned to their families and have reason to believe they'll be returned to their families immediately. During the time that I have been with them, I have come to have a tremendous respect for their courage and for their integrity. They have experienced an ordeal which requires unimaginable physical and emotional strength. I would like to give you a brief but factual explanation of some of the steps leading to their arrival in New York City tonight to clear the so-called mystery that surrounds them. First, the decision to release the three sergeants was made by the National Liberation Front of South Vietnam as a gesture of goodwill from the front to all the Americans who are disgusted by the war in Vietnam, and in particular to black Americans who sacrifice their lives on the front lines but suffer second-class status at home. Second, the Liberation Front communicated its interest in releasing prisoners during talks this last September with members of the anti-war movement, including myself, in Bratislava, Czechoslovakia, Bratislava, during a conference which included 41 Americans and an almost equal number of North and South Vietnamese. The official decision by the Liberation Front to liberate the three prisoners was made on October 31st. From that point on came the concrete process of their liberation. My own role in this process was strictly a humanitarian one, to facilitate the release and the departure of the three sergeants from Phnom Penh, Cambodia, and to help them in any way that they asked. The National Liberation Front made all necessary arrangements with the Cambodian authorities, including continuous medical treatment for Sergeant Johnson, who was given medical supplies to take with him on the plane. A committee of American anti-war leaders was immediately organized to help in this process, and I have been authorized to be their representative.
In recent weeks, protest has also escalated on the college campuses of the nation. There have been two major targets, military recruiters and recruiters for the Dow Chemical Company. Dow makes napalm. Its recruiters and representatives normally do not debate at the universities they visit. In fact, they have not often been able to recruit in the past month because of the protests. But last week, Dean Wakefield, a Dow public relations official, agreed to appear at New York University.
First of all, a word or two of background about my presence on the campus today. Originally, a campus group, which I believe Mr. Gordon represents, made a request that a Dow recruiter appear before this group. And the office of the president of the university at Washington Square was informed of this intention. And Dr. Whiteman, the assistant chancellor, suggested that since a recruiter had a job to do here, and since I had agreed to go to the Washington Square campus to meet with a group at the Washington Square campus tomorrow, that I come here instead. That I, rather than the recruiter, appear before you today. So if this particular process of bringing me here on campus has the appearance of taking any play away from the student-faculty group who originally turned in a request for an appearance, that purely and simply is how it happened. Some facts about the involvement of the Dow Chemical Company with napalm. And I say some facts, these are some relatively little-known facts. First of all, there are two types of napalm. There is napalm, which is the old traditional type of napalm, which you may be familiar with as having been used in World War II and the Korean War. Then there's napalm B, which is the current version of napalm, the version that's being used in Vietnam, which is composed of 50% polystyrene, 25% gasoline, 25% benzene, and polystyrene, 50% is our product. It was discovered about 3 years ago by some Air Force scientists who called for samples of polystyrene to be submitted from various suppliers of that plastic bead product around the country. One of the samples which Dow provided was chosen as being the best product for this particular application. And then the government asked for bids on contracts. And in some of them, we were the low bidder. And that very shortly is how we became a supplier of napalm. It's not a product of Dow research. We are not, as many of you perhaps believe, pouring millions of dollars into researching better ways of making it stick to people. It is, in fact, bathtub chemistry, simple chemistry. Okay, what's our attitude about this? Well, essentially, you've seen it, or you should have read it, because we've reiterated it time and again to the press, to the point where I'm tired of it, and probably you are too. That is that we're supplier to the Defense Department and to a dozens of other firms manufacturing items of military equipment, ranging all the way from food and medicine to aircraft components. And one of the goods we happen to supply is napalm. The United States is involved in Vietnam. As long as we are involved, we believe in fulfilling our responsibility to a national commitment of a democratic society. And we do this, we believe this, because we believe in the long-term goals of this country. It's quite simple. You may or may not admit of another point of view, but that's it. I don't really think I want to say any more. I'd really get questions.
Not only I don't think we should discuss whether napalm is inefficient or not. I suppose if that company, that chemical company is making it, it should be at least efficient doing its job. However, my question is this.
Mr. Wakefield seemed to imply
he seemed to imply that his company should be completely divorced of opinion or action upon what the government is doing. But it happens that industry is a powerful lobby. lobby. And the only way, and voting is not the only way to get things done. Pressure is very important. Certainly, industry is a gigantic pressure. It's been so throughout history, and it is so now. Like the universities, and like other third parties and political pressure groups, industry is vital in determining, in influencing a president. So my question is this: how can you, as a human being, as well as representative of a company, feel that your industry is divorced from making any moral or political decisions about the war? Just following blindly what the government dictates.
I didn't say that. I don't believe that we are following blindly. I believe that we have made a conscious, rational decision. Now, whether or not you agree with the result of that
decision?
Sorry?
Would you as a human being support that decision?
Yes, I do.
Since the director of the Senate, he agrees with the decision, I think what we should do is, if possible, direct our questions toward that decision, all right? That is, why we are in Vietnam, whether we have a right to be in Vietnam, and what the exact situation in Vietnam, as far as can be ascertained by objective report, is.
I'm sorry, Mr. Gordon. I don't think it's possible to wait until you speak to the policy.
No, this is
what he got.
I answered very directly in reference, Mr. Gordon, to whether or not I agree with our decision to produce and to continue to produce napalm. And I said, yes, I do. I think that has full bearing on whether or not, how you reach, how you make the next step.
I feel the question that is the presumption that your decision to make napalm was therefore going along with government policy.
This program began with the October 17th demonstrations in Oakland. On October 16th, there was a comparatively nonviolent demonstration at Oakland, where one of the participants was Joan Baez. KPFA's Colin Edwards speaks with Ms. Baez and describes the action that followed.
Ms. Baez, you've been asked this question before, I know, but why are you here today?
I felt that this was worth doing civil disobedience for, and I thought that today, being the nonviolent oriented, I would like to participate. And what I wanted to do was just simply to confront, you know, personally and then through the press and however it was put across in the newspapers to confront as many people as possible on the question of draft and this particular war and any war. Because I think that eventually it all has to go, or we'll probably blow ourselves up. And this seemed like a reasonable approach for me, a female, to put myself in the same, as close as I can, in the same position to a boy who refuses the draft by signing a statement I sign, saying I'm aiding and abetting the young men who don't want to cooperate with the draft. Then that can put me 5 years in jail, and I figured, you know, that's only proper for me to do, and then today I wanted to come here and sit in as well.
There have been demonstrations, picketing, protests at which people have been arrested before, but it doesn't seem to have made one iota of difference to the administration that's gone ahead and escalating the war. Therefore, what effect do you think this will have today? Would it stop a single plane or a military man going to Vietnam, or a single bullet being shipped there?
Well, those things are very possible. It would stop a man from going, that it would stop a bullet from being least aimed. You know, I mean, I've gotten lots of mail from young men who said they've put down their gun, you know, even when they're in Vietnam, from things that they've heard or they've suddenly been moved. But I don't think that you can, I think I would be kidding myself to think that this would be, you know, this is going to be the demonstration to end the war or something like that. On the other hand, if I don't continue to speak out whenever I feel I have to, and if people don't continue doing civil action, then I think the only living spark would die, and then, you know, then I think it would really be hopeless.
Now, some of the demonstrators here were arrested today outside the other door, and you stand in danger of being arrested. You know that, I suppose?
Yes, I know. My mother was. She was in the other door.
Have you been arrested before in these demonstrations?
No, I've never been to jail.
How do you face that prospect?
Well, I don't know. You just sort of get there, I suppose, you know.
A uniformed guard, Negro gentleman, is inside the building. Appeared at the door inside and is opening it up, apparently. At least he...
Okay.
gentleman, a civilian, is insisting on being allowed into the building. The police are trying to persuade him to go into another entrance, but he is insisting on his right to go in through this entrance. A great assembly of police, it looks like a company-sized force of police, is moving up in front of the building now with their nightsticks brandished in their hands, and they're now moving in on the demonstrators with their helmeted police bullhorns. Looks as if the demonstrators are going to be arrested. Miss Baez and her friends are still sitting on the ground. The police are pushing back the newsmen. They have their clipboards with the arresting sheets ready.
Lieutenant Briggs, an official of the General Service Administration, has just notified you that you are really trespassing, that you are blocking the doorway and interfering with the normal business of the induction center. This is a violation of Section 602J of the California Penal Code. If you fail to leave, as he has requested, you will place yourself under liability of arrest. If you fail to leave, this will be considered a lawful assembly, and I will so declare it. Do you wish to leave?
The week Joan Baez was arrested saw 994 draft cards and certificates of complicity with draft refusers turned in to the Justice Department. It culminated with the March on the Pentagon, the turning point for most youthful anti-war protesters. At 12:30 in the morning, after a day which became increasingly violent, some of them spoke with Harvey Davidson.
Yeah, those guys got hit over and over again with steel rifle butts, right in the front line, just sitting down there doing nothing. The guys kept moving up out of the clubbing with steel rifle butts.
They're arresting everybody up there. Nobody's...
I saw one guy just going 20 times with a steel rifle butt for just sitting there.
They decided just to go limp, so not to hold on to each other, so that they would get there alive instead of dead.
I never saw anything like it in my life. You think they were fighting some foreign invasion. And these are Americans trying to protect American liberties. And they club them with steel rifle butts.
I've seen brutality in the utmost. I mean, guys get literally beat to the ground and head stomped in and everything. And one guy, the bayonets, you know, trying to stab him with bayonets. It was bad. I mean,
those MPs, marshals, or what?
The marshals are the worst of all.
The marshals are the worst because
when they haul you off.
Look at their faces if you want to.
When they haul you off.
A thing of horror.
They drop you once or twice.
They're having
on the
a
ground.
Wonderful time. The soldiers aren't and when
quite
they
that bad.
You're not speaking to my committee. Listen, predominantly the problem here was that the marshals continuously egged on the soldiers. In other words, they would stand behind the soldiers and they pushed them into the crowd.
The soldiers
really, most of them, I don't think, wanted to fight. I saw a lot of the soldiers look away when the violence happened.
I agree.
They could not look at what was happening. And the marshals, who were dressed in a tie and jacket type of outfit, would grab people. I mean, literally grab them by the collar and just beat you in the head as hard as they could. And I was sitting right on the front line. And I left, personally, I left, because my head is not going to be smashed that way. I'm not going to fight them with a water pistol. And I think the day for marches may have been over today. Because a lot of people, I'm from one of them, I'm not coming anymore to get my head smashed in. If I go, I'm going to take somebody with me. And that's the way I feel.
This is a great U.S. government. It used to be, can forget it. It sounded great before, but now that you know the inside truth, it doesn't sound too good anymore. If this is democracy, I don't think it will work too good.
And you have the military police on your neck. I mean, who do you turn to for protection when you have these Nazis on your head? Who do you have to turn to? There's nobody else.
For quite a few people, it's probably the first real run-in with government and bureaucracy and just the whole corporation thing, and people don't like it, the vast majority of them. I mean, it's one thing to pay taxes and read papers, and it's another thing to get your head split in by the U.S. government's orders.
Yeah, we were sitting up there, and we saw the troops come, and every 15 minutes, they just move in another couple of feet, and people didn't move. They got hit with billy clubs. Four, five, six, seven, eight times, just beaten until they did move or got carried off.
These kids aren't fanatics. We're not extremists, and we're not martyrs, you know? Kids up there are scared. There's a girl from Cape Cod, an Irish Catholic. She was all set to get arrested, you know? I mean, like, something's got to be wrong. These people, these are not the fanatics.
The only reason she's not up there is because I dragged her down, because I'm too much of a coward to stay myself.
I don't think the press is saying exactly what's going on. I heard on the radio that there was reports of tear gas, unconfirmed reports that they said that the people were bringing their own tear gas.
Yeah.
Yeah. They said that.
Yes. On the news tonight. Mm-hmm. Do you think? I think that. This is making a definite impression in the minds of American people. Some of the people that are afraid don't want to step out a little bit and express their views completely. These people, a lot of these people are doing a good job. I don't know how many people are here tonight.
Several thousand.
How many people turned out today for the demonstration? 10,000? 100,000?
I think 100.
I think that the military has been a little bit too harsh beating people. This is supposed to be a peaceful demonstration. And they've used tactics a little bit too severe. That's about all I can
say. Thanks very much.
I know just enough to know it's dangerous. What?
Give me first aid.
We're going to go up and look right now. I sent an ambulance up there. You probably saw it just a while ago.
Okay, I'm a Peace Corps volunteer. I just had Peace Corps training.
Okay, fine. But I want to know that you're down here so that in case we can, fine. Get you up there, then you know you will be available. Okay, then fine. But the rest of you, stay on the committee. No idea. It depends upon what Bill says. He's up there. He's a master in these things. If in fact they can keep their cool, there's not going to be confrontation. Otherwise, they'll do what they've been doing so far, using one man as an excuse to pick up four or five others, and they'll keep it up all night long.
Nothing would ever be quite the same for those involved in that demonstration. All physical mass actions would now be talked of as resistance. A reaction to the Pentagon protest from Jeff Jones and Jeff Shiro of Students for a Democratic Society.
I think that there is clearly going to be a significant change, and in fact that change has been visible in the anti-war protests of the last 2 weeks. The rhetoric of the confrontation in Washington was one of from dissent to resistance. And we were trying to learn what that would mean in terms of American society, to learn how we could become a force of resistance to this society. And we'll find that increased militancy, more serious confrontations with people who hold the power will be occurring both on the campuses and the communities where the people live. Our involvement with the October 21st demonstration began when about 2 weeks before it was supposed to be held, we heard that permits were not going to be issued to the demonstrators. At that point, we felt it was important for all of the SDS people to come and join with the rest of the anti-war activists around the country in the demonstration. Later, when the permits were given, we learned that they had called in upwards of 20,000 troops to Washington, D.C., and that almost 3,000 of those troops would be surrounding the Pentagon. At that point, it became clear to us that we had to march to the Pentagon to confront those troops and to confront the Pentagon, which is the symbol for U.S. imperialism around the world, and say to that symbol and to the American people that we are struggling and we are going to try to find a way to end that imperialism, to change this America.
It is particularly significant, though, that for the first time, we weren't the people that were isolated. It was the government that was isolated. Now, you can stop and look at the polls, but that doesn't really tell the story. The mood of people was aggressive. They felt that the bulk of the people in America were against the war, that Johnson was manipulating with the help of the media, with the help of the power structure of this country. And you can see that manifest in very clear ways. For instance, two of the soldiers guarding the Pentagon came across to the marchers, and the demonstrators on the Pentagon tier chanted, "Join us, join us, join us." And then, after a little while, one of the guards with his bayonet, he took off his helmet and threw it down and came towards the marchers to join us. And they rushed out and grabbed him and hauled him away. And the whole dynamic has changed now. America's revolted by this war. Our sense of humanity is outraged. And I think that it's now Johnson that's isolated. And I bet you if the country's around 10 years from now, it's Johnson that'll be the joke, and the demonstrators will be the hero.
The change was apparent 2 weeks later, when Secretary of State Dean Rusk spoke before the Foreign Policy Association at the New York Hilton. The younger demonstrators engaged in what were later described as mobile tactics, moving as the police moved. The police response was greater violence than had ever been seen at a New York demonstration. It was called a new riot. At the least, for New York City, it was a new type of civil disorder.
The policeman was riding his horse near the crowd. There are no barricades here. The fire engines are trying to get through. At the corner of 50th and 6th, 735, here where the fire engines are at 50th and 6th, there are no barricades. There are only policemen with horses. Demonstrators in the middle of the street.
Hey, hi! Hi! Leo's over there.
Moving down 6th Avenue toward 49th. Demonstrators in the street, fire engines aren't getting through, they're bringing more police in here. More police are coming in. Police pushing the demonstrators back. Police shove all the demonstrators back to the east side of 6th. Police hitting demonstrators now, more demonstrators are moving in. From across the street, the police are going to be caught between...
Into the street.
Hey, watch where you're going.
Now there are police, demonstrators behind the police, police charging at the demonstrators. Demonstrators moving back. Police charging. Police charging. Fire engines have finally gotten through here. On the other side of this street, there are only police horses, not enough police. And there's another fire engine still trying to get through this street. It's 20 to 8, we're between 50th and 49th on 6th. Demonstrators are all the way down here. Hotel, between 53rd. 52nd. Traffic is being rerouted here at 48th Street. No traffic on 6th between 48th and 50th.
What a sidewalk!
Now the crowd is moving from the sidewalk into the middle of the street from the west side of the street. They're bringing in more policemen to guard the east side of the street. people move off the west side of the street and move back. Now demonstrators are coming from around the corner of 50th and 6th. There's really no thorough police control. Now police moving down the street toward 49th. More police being moved in. Demonstrators moving down toward 48th Street. Police are chasing. There's a policeman with a horse galloping down the street. Demonstrators running down the street. It looks like the horse is tracing the demonstrators.
West side. Right here, right here.
Crowd running. There's no people on the sidewalks except those moving down the street between 49th and 48th. Solid line of people in front of me as we approach 48th at 6th. At 20 minutes to 8, this chaos on the streets has now been going on about 10 minutes. They've got cars blocked here in the streets at 48th Street. People standing in the streets, police chasing them. Now there's a car trying to get through. There are barrels in the middle of the street. Police moving down the street here at the corner of 48th and 6th. Demonstrators periodically moving back and forth. There are very few policemen down here. Now more policemen come marching down from 49th Street. Simply doesn't look like there will be enough police here unless they bring in more reinforcements to maintain continuous control of the crowd between 48th and 50th. More policemen and more demonstrators still moving down here, corner of 6th Avenue and 48th Street. Police attempting to move cars through as fast as possible. Cars, some of them literally driving over people. Now they're moving down toward 47th Street, where a policeman is riding into, is ridden into. There's a taxi driver just drove into someone, almost hit him. Policeman chasing the crowd. This is utter chaos down here.
In the coming week, the nation will see another escalation of protest. On December 4th, draft cards will again be turned in around the country. And in New York, the Whitehall Street Induction Center will be the site of a nonviolent December 5th sit-in by adults supporting youthful draft refusal. But the nation's attention is most likely to be focused on New York, December 6th through 8th, when mobile tactics will again be used by the protesters to shut down the Whitehall Street Center. A preview of the week, as Steve Kagan of the Stop the Draft Week Committee addresses a meeting of marshals for that demonstration.
Due to circumstances beyond its control, Whitehall Induction Center will be closed next Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. Crucial to the success of this demonstration. We are all here as marshals. We are here and we're going to be at the demonstration next Wednesday in order to see that the purposes of the demonstration are carried out and that we have a successful demonstration. All right, now what are we going to do? At 5:30 in the morning, we will all have already arrived and assembled in Battery Park, gotten all of our instructions, our last-minute instructions. By 5:30, all of the demonstrators will start arriving, and they'll be coming by the subway. Most of them will be coming up from the South Ferry area. Now, the bulk of the demonstrators will assemble with us in the northeast area of Battery Park. And a large segment of them will also assemble in front of the Governor's Island ferry slip, which is down at South Street, the very tip of Manhattan. Now, it'll take us a little while to get together, and we plan at 6:30 to leave the assembly areas in three major groups and go to make our protest against the draft and to close down the Whitewell Street Induction Center. Now, the three groups will go in the following manner. Out of the South Ferry area down here will come one group, which will simply go right up Whitewell Street. Whitewell Street feeds right into that area. Out of the Battery Park area on top, there are two groups. One will go over to Broad Street, and down Broad Street, which leads to the area behind the induction center, and the other group will go right down Whitewell Street to the induction center. Now, our view is that this war is an illegal, an immoral war, a war against the interests of the Vietnamese and American people, and that the draft is the major tool by which this war is carried out, that the draft thus becomes an illegal and immoral institution in itself. And our purpose is for, to the extent that we can, to prevent this institution from functioning. And that is why we are going there. And that's something that we all have to understand, and this, I think, is something we all do understand. Our enemy is the war in Vietnam. Our enemy is the conditions which produced the war in Vietnam and other wars of this type. And our immediate goal is to stop the institution which is feeding the war in Vietnam. Okay, now the way we plan to do that, then, is in these three groups to descend on the Whitehall Street building, which occupies an entire block in itself, and to stand around that building and to prevent that building from functioning by preventing people from going into the building. It's as simple as that. Now we're going to move in a very orderly, in a very disciplined manner. And that's the reason we have so many of you as marshals and why we have so many people as marshal captains. Marshals, all of you, will be moving with the three groups that go down to the Whitehall Street Center. Your function, your major function, is going to be to keep everybody moving steadily, without bunching up, without crowding each other, without pushing in the direction that we want to go. We are not going to Whitehall Street to create violence. We are not going there with any intention of trampling on the rights of anyone. We are going there for the purpose of preventing the draft from functioning. Now, as a policy of this, of the Stop the Draft Week Committee, that we are not going to allow physical assaults on anyone, whether they be bystanders, policemen, or members of our own demonstration. We are not going to be arrested. We are not going to inflict violence on people. We are not going to have violence inflicted upon ourselves. I think that should be made perfectly clear. We're going to have an orderly and peaceful demonstration. But we are going with the purpose not simply of stating our objective to the war and the draft, but preventing it from functioning. That should be clear up to this point, right? Okay. Now when you come, when this group comes down to Battery Park on Wednesday morning, and we line up all the people who are leaving Battery Park, and those of you who are assigned down to the South Ferry area, and we line up the people who start going up Whitehall Street, we will divide into groups, and you will be assigned to the groups. And the group will try to stick together for the entire day. And the groups will be identified by color. All the marshals, all of you will be given white armbands, but the armbands will have a circle or blob of identifiable color. And it should be, we're planning to have about 10 of these groups. The marshals, again, will move with the group. The group will stay together. We don't want to break into small bands. At the same time, though, we don't want to bunch up or get packed into each other. Is that clear? Okay. Each group, each major group, each of the major three groups will be under the direction, first of all, of marshal captains who will lead the three groups. Also, there will be marshal captains posted at various places to help facilitate movement. Now, all of you will be responsible to marshal captains. Marshal captains are in turn responsible to the chief marshals, who have already gotten their instructions from the steering committee and the working committee, which are the policy-making bodies. And the crucial thing here is that you are not being asked to take on responsibility for making any kind of involved decisions, but you are being asked to take on the very important responsibility of facilitating easy motion, of preventing violence, and of preventing assaults on persons who are with us or against us.
There will be disorder around the induction center, and it is certain it will be denounced by public officials and known commentators. The more peaceful protests, the petitions, perhaps electoral activity, will be suggested as reasonable alternatives. And it should be noted, such protests will indeed continue to take place. But the war's greatest effect is on the young, and the young who oppose the war have become an opposition which, day by day, becomes a resistance to all connected with the power of the America it sees. Their protest will escalate as the war itself escalates, and in the streets of America there will be no peace until there is peace in Vietnam. This is Steve Buchester reporting for WBAI.
We have heard Vietnam, the opposition. The program was produced for Pacifica Radio by Stephen Buchester of WBAI's News and Public Affairs Department.